So the notion of social imaginary is not a very clear-cut concept. There is no major critical or theoretical examination of this concept in the discipline of history. And if some brilliant and prominent historian used it and explicitly demand for it, they are very few. We can cite Alain Corbin, which Mias Belajonki was subtitled L'odorat et l'imaginaire social, or of course Sarah Maza, Myth of the French Bourgeoisie, also subtitled Essay on the Social Imaginary. But there are very few, and none of them have really tried to clarify the notion. Other fields, such as literary studies, sociology, or philosophy, have published theoretical reflection on social imaginary, but they have little been discussed by historians. Two additional problems have limited the historical use of the notion of imaginary. The first one is related to the intellectual history of the concept. Not only was imaginary in complete contradiction with facts and reality, which was long regarded as the only legitimate object for history, but the notion of imaginary itself has been introduced in the humanities and in social sciences by disciplines that clearly rejected history. Imaginary was first introduced by psychoanalysts like Jung, for instance, then by philosopher Gaston Bachelard in France, and above all by structural anthropology, and especially Gilbert Durand. Famous and seminal book, Les structures anthropologiques de l'imaginaire, first published in 1960, and whose the influence of this book was powerful and in the whole field of social sciences and limited the inroad of historian in this field. Imaginary, the imaginary, Durand argues, is built on a very limited number of schemas. Archetypes, he took the word from Jung, and which he describes as steady. One page is missing, I'm really sorry.
Thank you.
Which he described, yes, as a completely steady, invariant, universal, and at last completely unhistorical. They are just irreducible organizers of mind, myth archetypes and myth themes, as he said. No history of imaginary was possible in his perspective, for history was in itself an imaginary, just useful to produce narratives of coherence and narratives of legitimacy. Even if Gilbert Durand admitted almost two decades later that some turning points could exist, his work has very intimidating consequences, all the more since he inspired many great works in anthropology, literary theory, and mythocriticism. The philosophers who work later and with other perspectives in this field, Castorialis, but I will come back on that point later, or Charles Taylor in Canada, have been very little discussed by historians. So the introduction of the concept of imaginary occurred in a context that strongly limited and marginalized history as a discipline. However, we all know that the new history, la nouvelle histoire, introduced by medievalists in the 70s, strongly rejected this approach. Scholars like Georges Duby or Jacques Le Goff in France refused the concept of archetypes. Le Goff wrote that archetypes were flight of fancy. They denied the idea of a stable imaginary and emphasized the existence of strong evolution due to social change or cultural change. Indeed, many historians took then a great interest in this question, but, and this is the second problem, in complete lexical and conceptual confusion. L'histoire des imaginaires sociaux a longtemps été pratiquée sous d'autres dénominations, Alain Corbin wrote rightly. But the problem was less the use of other terms or other categories than the vagueness. the Encyclopédie de la Nouvelle Histoire, written in 1978 by Le Goff, Revel, and others, described imaginary as one of the 10 key concepts of the annals schools, but does not define it. Many books published then by anthropological history use imaginary as a concept, but they use it as a synonymous or an equivalent of other notions, mentalities, beliefs, collective representation, mental representation. George Duby's very famous book, Les Trois Ordres ou l'imaginaire du féodalisme, fluctuates from the idea of myth, influenced by the work of Dumézil, to ideology. Another famous medievalist, Jack Le Goff, tried in this book to define the notion more precisely. He distinguished ideology and symbolic from imaginary, defined as the creative part, the poetic part, the dynamic part of the field of representation. Imaginary, in his view, was distinguished of ideology, but the term continued to be used with vagueness in the same way, in fact, as mentality. In fact, imaginary seemed to take over mentalities and suffer in consequence with the same discredit. This doubt about the nature of imaginary was coupled with another doubt about the nature of social. What does this adjective social really mean in the expression social imaginary? The strategic interest of the term is obvious. To speak of social imaginary means that we are clearly located in the realm of history and not in the field of immobile and structural anthropology. Social meant dynamic, mobile, in connection with context, with changing context. The addition of the adjective clearly confirms that we have to do now with collective issue, with individual and groups interaction. It is history in its most vivid production. But once this principle is stated, one can identify at least three different meanings of this term social. The first one, which is the most respected but also the most productive, is to consider the social imaginary as the different ways to conceive, to describe, or to represent the components of the social world. This approach has been well summarized by the book of the Polish philosopher and historian Bronislaw Baszko. The book is not translated into English, I think. Les Imaginaires Sociaux. Social imaginary, Baszko argues, is a current and dynamic set of representation of the social world, a kind of repertory of the figure and of the identities created and used by society at different moments of the histories. Social imaginaries, in his view, describe the way society perceives their components, groups, class, categories, nation, supranations, the way they justify the hierarchies, and the way they imagine the future. Works like famous book of Benedict Anderson about nation, or of course books devoted to representation of social category, Sarah's Bourgeoisie, Drew Roman Victorian Middle Class, Patrick Joyce People, Deborah Cohen People in France, clearly pertain to this approach. This conception of the social world is not limited to groups or categories. It can also concern social positions, social relations, and all the process of social promotion or social decline or social interaction. This is, for instance, the kind of social imaginary that Judith Lioncamp searched in her study of the letters by readers to Balzac and to Eugène Sue. A different and wider approach is to consider the social imaginary as the expression of the desire, obsession, fantasies, anxieties, dreams, fear, prejudice, beliefs, in short, the feelings and the sensibilities of a society at a given time. This approach assumes the problematic, in my view, existence of shared sensibilities beyond class, gender, race, or age distinction, or at the least, the possibility of large phenomena of collective sensibilities. However, it gave birth to remarkable studies such as Jean de Lumeau's book on the great fear which affected the Western world at the end of the Middle Ages, or of course, Alain Corbin's book about the revolution of the sense of smell or the changing perception of the shore at the turn of the 18th and 19th century. A last and more structural approach is to consider the social imaginary as the framework able to institute the order, the references, and the norms of the social world. Cornelius Castoriadis' major book, L'Institution Imaginaire de la Société, first published in 1975, constitutes the main reference in this perspective. Assuming that each society auto-establishes itself, there is no extra social reference, no extra social determination in Castoriadis' way. He considered that this process, that he called social historical, finds its roots and realizes itself in imaginary, which appears at the matrix of all the social representations. According to him, the social imaginary is a kind of system of meanings that organize all the conception and all the representation of a society, even of a time, and produce its institutions. In a different but parallel perspective, the Canadian philosopher Charles Taylor tried to understand the nature of modernity through the way of imagining the social life, social expectation, and practices. However, this tripartition is more didactic than intellectual, for these three conceptions continuously overlap. To think and to describe the representation of a group or social class in the wake of Bashko's definition necessarily requires mobilizing studies in terms of emotion and sensibilities, and leads finally to a global understanding of the whole social world. It is, in any case, in that sense that I have tried to consider the social imaginary in the recent book I devoted to Les Bas-Fonds, which is the book and the original illustration of a late 19th century book. This expression, which was coined in France in its social meaning in 1840, and which appears in most of the Western languages at the same moment, Bajos Fondos in Spanish, Bassi Fondi in Italian, Sottomondo in Italian, Underworld in English, which appeared in the US in its social meaning in 1869, in a very interesting book, this one. Well, all this word appeared in the same time in the Western world, Unterwelt in Germany immediately after. This world clearly aims to describe a social world, the world of the destitute, the vagrants, the criminal, the prostitute, so on, at a moment, the beginning of the 19th century, where economical change, but also urban, politic, and religious changes deeply modify the outlook of the social margins. This world is then described as the gathering and intricacy of poverty, extreme poverty, vice, and crime. This is the three main components. These three components converge to threaten and to destroy the very basis of the social order. We are, in my view, clearly facing a social imaginary. I don't contend that the poor, the beggars, the prostitute, the criminal, or the gangs do not exist. Unfortunately, we all know that they exist. They do exist. But there is little chance they look like the picturesque and horrifying representation given by most of the 19th century narratives. Let's try to lay out briefly the complex system of representation tied during the 19th century to this notion of the Bas-Fonds. Articulation of crime, vice, and poverty is the main and decisive feature. The proportion of the mixture can vary. The focus can also vary according to cultural or ideological position. You can have poverty gives birth to vice, which gives birth to crime, or vice versa. Well, you can imagine all the combinations. But the three components is a permanent feature. It indicates an historical moment when the idea of transgression and its political danger wavers between the traditional approach, moral approach, to the new social approach. Extreme poverty, vice, and crime build an imaginary marked by three main features. This is a world swept away to the bottom, tracing a movement of descent toward basement, toward subterraneans, caverns, quarries, pitfalls, catacombs, and so on. In a word, a world carried along in a fall, in the biblical meaning of the word fall, which has, of course, something to do with hell. This is a world that sinks. It dives into the depths, going always deeper and corrupting itself in that movement. It becomes finally a world in opposition, an anti-world where everything is upside down. The future of this world is death, madness, decline. If this world is dragged down to the bottom, it is also a world of the low and the bottom in a corporeal meaning. In the sense that Michael Bakhtin gave to the lower bodily strata of the body. Its scatological dimension. It's the realm of flesh, of fat, of filthy part, of sex, of excrement. Hence the grotesque dimension of the Bas-Fonds, and of course its scatological element and emphasis on prostitution, perverse sexuality, and so on. Dirtiness, both moral and physical and material, is linked to this dimension. The underworld is the domain of cesspits, of trash, of dumps, of putrid, of infected and oozing dampness. It is an ugly and hideous world in which men pile up and squeeze in. It's also a world of disease in which humidity, viscous air, infection threaten on a material as well as on a symbolical way. Paradoxically, this savage and wild world is also described as a world made by a strong organization into a hierarchy. From the first representation of the Gregory, La Cour des Miracles, that emerging during the 16th century, most narratives insist on the existence of a very structured, organized, and secret counter-society. It is the function of the argot, of course, which serves as well as a professional language, language of theft, vice, and crime, and as an instrument of coercion and of concealment. This language creates a nation, even a race, which is the one of duplicity, for no values can be established in such a flooding context, since language itself is falsified and covers being and thing in an unfathomable moral mist. Obviously, these Bas-Fonds don't really exist, at least not in the way as they are described in the narrative. It is a representation, a complex cultural construction born at the crossroad of philanthropy, of theory of social reform, of social betterment, of moralization, of social control, but also of literature, of a wish for escapism, a wish for social exoticism, a wish for sensationalism. For the gathering in some low and awful places of all the dropouts and the organization in counter-society pertain to fantasy. And when such gathering actually existed, they were the result of a legal and state process which gathered the destitute, the beggar, the thief, the prostitute, the lunatic in some closed places, the French Hôpital Général, beside the Victorian workhouses, the New York's Blackwood's Island, and many other places we spoke just before of buying the Guyane, created actual Bas-Fonds. Hence the power of institutionalization of such imaginary and their historical meaning. The history of the Bas-Fonds provides, in my view, a good example of what a social imaginary is in its different acception. No doubt, they offer description of a social group, of a social world, group, categories. These descriptions are obviously forced, excessive, outrageous, and fantastic, but clearly inscribed in a social dimension. Unlike the traditional representation of beggars and bandits of the early modern time, which were usually described as the product of immorality or of a remarkable destiny, the Bas-Fonds, or the underworld, affirm a clear social dimension, starting with the identification with the new working classes. created by urban and economic change. They provide a repertoire of types, figure, behavior that clearly constitute a social world. Besides, this world is not a static one. It draws a set of social positions, relationships, interaction, and is also involved in a social strategy to destroy the world above. In a brilliant chapter of Les Misérables, precisely titled Le Bas-Fonds, Hugo sums up the social goal of this world, the social goal of this world. Il a pour but l'effondrement de tout. Il ne mine pas seulement dans son fourmillement hideux l'ordre social actuel, il mine la philosophie, il mine la science, il mine le droit, il mine la pensée humaine, il mine le progrès, il est ténèbres et il veut le chaos. But this description of a social world also mobilizes a full range of feelings, emotions and sensitivities between abjection and fascination, which constitute their two sensory extremes. Les Bas-Fonds appear as a powerful emotional matrix. On the one hand, pity, compassion, erotic desire for dirty and corrupt flesh. On the other hand, disgust, repulsion, and above all, fear. Whether concerning beggars, criminals, prostitutes, lunatics, or convicts, one of the major functions of this Bas-Fonds is to embody the threat and the fear, to institute the figures that crystallize social anxiety. The participation of such an imaginary to the understanding of society as a whole also appears clearly. It is worth noting that these representations of the social margin always present themselves as the exact antithesis of the world above. They always work as an inverted world. In the early modern time, when it was time of kingdoms, of corporations, of orders, of estate generals, the Bas-Fonds were described as cour, cour des miracles, as kingdom, la monarchie d'Argot, as estate generals of crimes, of begging and of robbery. During the French Revolution, they were in charge of a new model in P, I don't know the first name, just the first letter, P. Leclerc, History of the Chauffeur, first published in 1799. The bandits gathered in a council decide to imitate the new organization of the revolution of the revolutionary France, shared into départements, arrondissements, and cantons. I quote, "La révolution opérée en France inspira à Fleur d'Épine, the chief of the bandits, le grand dessein de modifier son système politique et de singer les établissements respectables du nouveau régime en régénérant le sien." When the 19th century, in search of a new way of interpreting the social world, invented the concept of class, the Bas-Fonds became class, dangerous classes, predatory classes, criminal classes. In the revanchist France of 1870, they present themselves as the army of crime. And later, during the interwar period, one spoke of unions, cartels, concerns of crime. In this world of changing organization, the Bas-Fonds revealed their true nature to be the opposite, disguised, double of the actual society. Therefore, they can't exist separately from the other components of the social world. They act as a foil for the social order, pointing out the unacceptable forms of a collective life, consolidating and establishing accordingly the norm of the acceptable world. This function appears all the more important that the idea of Bas-Fonds usually revives or reorganizes itself in a period of deep change or of social anxiety, as if it was a tool for rethinking the contours of a social world in crisis. Let's conclude with a more practical question. What kind of methodological or interpretive profits can the use of this complex notion, social imaginary, provide to historians? Are things really different if we use the Dawkinian concept of collective representation, or the notion of system of representation suggested by cultural history? What do we gain in using a so poorly defined concept? Three aspects can be highlighted in my view. The first one regards the corpus of sources. To think in terms of social imaginary requires convening a very large range of sources without a priori distinction about their nature. That means combining official description and fictions, academic discourse and popular images, the legitimate and the illegitimate, the true and the false. My study of the underworld, for instance, is as well documented by sociological, philanthropic surveys or medical treaties, as well by songs, novels, newspapers, reports, movies, and poetry. Such a way of writing history requires, of course, having an expert knowledge of the nature and context of each source, but it also necessitates thinking all these sources together, in their assembling, in their overlap, as well as in their clash, in short, in the movement given by life and given by the actor of history. Thank you. Gathering a dense source like that, a polyphonic source like that, a kind of proliferation of consistent and divergent representation, social imaginary hope to reproduce something of the dynamic of the life as it may have appeared to contemporaries. The resulting intertext, close to what the Quebecois Marc Angenot once called the social discourse, aims to restore the complexity of the social world, the almost infinite shimmer of its texture. But such an analysis requires, in my opinion, two complementary operations. How to find our way in such a tangle of sources? How to build a path in such a jungle of text, images, representation? The way out implies to identify organizer, which could be scripts, fictions, or narratives, what Paul Venn called imagination constituante. Imaginary, to be actual, need to take forms in plots, to tell stories, to give them to read or to see. That is why I completely agree with another Canadian scholar, Pierre Popovic, who proposed to define the social imaginary, I quote, as the interactive set of correlated representation organized in latent fictions. To understand a social imaginary, which is shifting, contradictory, tangled, needs to identify a small number of fiction, of narrative, of script that give it shape and meaning. That I've tried to do in that book, but I don't have the time to tell it. And finally, this way of identifying narrative is also the best way to date precisely an imaginary, which is very often made of different materials, sometimes very ancient material. For instance, my Bas-Fonds were made of something coming from the Bible, something other motive and pattern coming from Middle Ages. But the narratives which give them form, the assembly which give them form, is clearly located in a historical context, and the only way, in my view, to identify clearly this imaginary is to identify and to date clearly the narratives, the fiction, the script that gave form to all this complex. Thank you.